Hey there, I'm Jeff.
And I'm Steve.
And we're students at MIT.
Today we're going to be showing you some really cool things you can do with photography and science at home.
Things like this. We're here at the MIT Museum at the Doc Edgerton exhibit. Edgerton was a professor at MIT who pioneered the use of the stroboscope in photography to capture images like these. The strobe can be precisely triggered to illuminate the subject for only an instant, allowing the camera to capture a moment frozen in time. Today, instead of capturing an instant, we're going to be doing long exposure photography to capture events as they take place over time. Let's go back to the lab and meet up with Steve for some science.
Jeff, where's your lab coat?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Now that we're in proper lab attire, let's look at our basic camera setup. Here's our light source. This is our scene, which is at the focal distance of our lens. Here's our aperture, our shutter, and our piece of film or digital sensor.
Now, let's take a closer look at,
in this case, our sensor. We can think of each of these squares as representing a pixel, which cumulatively records light as it hits it.
Now, if we open up the aperture, we can see the image resolve on the sensor. By changing the size of the aperture, we control the amount of light that hits the sensor. Another way of controlling the light is with the shutter.
Because of the cumulative nature of the sensor, opening the shutter for a longer period of time means each pixel records a higher light count, resulting in a brighter image. This is the key to long exposure photography.
Now another way to understand it is to look at an example. Here I am in a dark room waving a flashlight around. The video you actually see is made up of successive photographs, or frames, played back to back at around 24 frames per second. If we superimpose all of these photographs together, we get a discrete approximation to what a long exposure of the scene would have looked like. This is due to the cumulative nature of the camera. Here's what the actual continuous long exposure of the scene looks like. Now that we're past the basics, let's talk about how you can do this at home.
First, you'll need a dark environment, a camera, a tripod or a steady place for the camera, a light source, and it helps to have a happy assistant.
Secondly, you need to set your camera to a very slow shutter speed. Typically at least 5 seconds or more. If you have a digital SLR, this is easy to do using manual or bulb mode. And if you have a compact camera, you can set the camera to fireworks or night mode to trick the camera into taking a long exposure.
Next, trigger the shutter and have you or your assistant wave a light in front of the camera to write words or draw shapes. After the shutter closes, you'll have your light painting.
There are many uses for long exposure photography, both scientific and artistic. For example, you can measure the speed of an object, like a car or a plane. Here we have a plane landing, and if we know the distances and the amount of time the shutter was open, we can actually calculate the speed of the plane.
You can also see the parabolic trajectory of an object if you have a glow-in-the-dark bouncy ball. From the long exposure, you can calculate the decay of bounces as well as notice that the path of the ball is brighter at the top of the arcs because it is moving more slowly near the apex.
Another cool application is astrophotography. If you use the stars as your light source, you can see the rotation of the Earth, and if you trace back to the center of rotation, you'll find the North Star.
Finally, if you're at MIT and just happen to have access to a high-tech robotic arm, you can do super precise light painting. Let's check it out.
We're here with the Mediated Matter Group at the MIT Media Lab, and we're using this arm to do light painting. By attaching a light to the end of the robotic arm, we can actually create light paintings like this. Because of the precise control of the arm, we can actually make animations where every successive video frame is its own light painting. We can also visualize hidden fields by attaching a sensor and controlling the brightness of the light with the sensor. For instance, this is my laptop, and you can see the magnetic field surrounding it.
Wow, that arm is pretty cool.
Definitely. But remember, you don't need a robotic arm, just a flashlight and a camera to try out light painting.
Yeah, well, that's the end of our video. We hope you enjoyed it.
And this was our first try doing this, so if you have any comments, suggestions, or even if you just want to share some photos with us, feel free to contact us at this right here. This will work.
Thanks for watching.